Mortarion eyed Skorvall's right arm. The limb ended just above the wrist, the stump hidden behind a greasy, blood-stained bandage. The injury was only a week old, a trophy from the closing stages of a fight against a dozen killbeasts. One of them had bitten off Skorvall's hand and swallowed it, but the warrior had still managed to rip out the monster's throat and drown it in its own blood. "What in the name of all that is cold?" Another familiar figure came to them through the throng, his broad face switching from a manic grin to a worried frown, and then back again. "Hunda, did you leave something behind out there?"
"No jokes, Jewel," Skorvall shot back, cradling his injured arm. "I am not in the mood."
"A killbeast tried to make a meal of him," Mortarion said levelly. "I believe he is so unpalatable that it choked to death."
"Now you mock me too,"
Skorvall's expression fell. "Ah, I understand why it died," said the new arrival. "You have bitter blood, Hunda. I've always said so." Mortarion clapped Skorvall on the back. "That's a good name for you. You'll have to keep it." Hunda Skorvall served the Death Guard Legion during the Great Crusade and Horus Heresy. Among the first of the Legion to be drawn from the aspirants of the Death Guard's newfound homeworld, Barbarus, Skorvall followed in the footsteps of his Primarch Mortarion to wage war across the stars. Having perceived his genesire as the liberator of his downtrodden people from a young age, whilst fighting the Overlord Xenos at his Primarch's side during the emancipation of his homeworld, Hunda proved himself to be a capable warrior alongside veterans of Barbarus such as Kalas Typhon and Durak Rask. Surviving the battles waged against the oppressors of his people, with Skorvall's ascension as a space marine, he would prove a valiant and noble companion to his lord. Honored with carrying the standard of the First Company's 19th chapter into battle, a skirmish with the Eldar upon the world of Neverlight resulted in a grievous wound. Interred within a dreadnought sarcophagus, his service as a contemptor proved to be exceptionally deadly in combat. Siding with the traitor rebels during the Horus Heresy, the so-called Bitterblood fought alongside his Primarch at the vanguard of the Battle of Istvan III. His chassis badly damaged by the Loyalist resistance, with the conclusion of the atrocity, Skorvall's dreadnought would be repaired, allowing for his deployment in the subsequent dropside massacre of Istvan V. Surviving the second catastrophic engagement, Skorvall would continue to stand at the vanguard of the Pale King's forces until their push towards Holy Terror with the conclusion of the war. Present during the Death Guard's traversal through the warp, orchestrated by their conniving first captain, Kalas Typhon, the Bitterblood watched his peers transform as they were gripped by the plagues and infections of their new benefactor, Nurgle. Reeling from the horror of the transformation of the junior Astartes, Raheb Zuriak, with his containment of the infection, his Primarch would observe the fell ruin that had befallen the Space Marine and Labor Serfs. Witnessing the form of more horrific mutilations than even those inflicted by the Overlords of Barbarus, Mortarion observed the still-living Astartes, slick with putrescence as he spat gobbets of phlegm, ripe flies and maggots burgeoning from the lesions of his skin as it sloughed from his bones. Apothecary Crozius remarked that Zuriak was infected with all known diseases at once, and despite the failure of many of his organs and rupture of his secondary heart, he was a vector for further plagues. As the warrior cried bloody, black tears, Mortarion felt an emotion he had seldom ever felt. Pity. Entering the chamber, Mortarion ended the agonized warrior's life, remarking,
"You are my loyal son. You have served the Death Guard with honor. You need suffer no more. Rest now."
Yet despite ending his Jean son's life, the body refused to submit to endless rest, convulsing and stumbling as it tore the knife from its chest like a crazed marionette. Nurgle would not allow his pawn to truly die, and the Pale King realized that he could not grant peace from this state of undeath. The Bitterblood looked on at the abominable state of his cherished kin, at the disgusting fate which he would never wish upon his most detestable foe. The fate of Hunda Skorvall henceforth remains unknown, the record of the corruption of his cherished friend epitomizing the tragic downfall of his legion.
Hunda!
The Bitterblood heard the whelp calling his name, and with irritable slowness, the old veteran allowed himself to come fully awake. His implanted auto-sensors flickered into action, the visual, infrared, ultraviolet, and terahertz wave phases all overlapping into a single mass of input.
Who speaks?
The question grated through the sour air of the arming chamber, issuing out of the vocoder module across the front of his armored form. The barrel-chested contemptor dreadnought shifted on his support frame, making the iron girders creak. He flexed the thick fingers of his combat fists and turned an optic towards the legionary standing in the chamber's doorway. A line death guard, but his sigils were those of Captain Calgaro's cohort, not of the First Company.
It is I, Zuyek.
The young warrior's reply seemed labored, almost as if he were out of breath, as impossible as that was for a Genhance legionary.
Raheb!
The Bitterblood generated a rough, sawtoothed noise that was as close as he could come to a chuckle.
What are you doing here? It has been too long, young one.
The humor faded.
Is something amiss?
Zuriek didn't answer, and instead, he made sharp gestures to the serfs and mecho menials who had been in the midst of performing a maintenance cycle on the venerable veteran's iron body. They took the hint and left quickly, leaving the two Death Guard warriors alone.
Calgaro told me to seek you out, said the legionary at length. We both agreed if anyone aboard the Terminus Est can be asked to have an honest eye on this ship, it would be Hunda Skorvall.
The Bitterblood laughed again.
An honest eye on this ship? Or its commander? I'll warrant you wish to know more about Typhon's intent than that of his vessel.
Aye.
That is the truth. Zuriek halted, leaning heavily against a guardrail.
For Blade's sake, why is it so infernally hot in here?
What say you?
The veteran checked his aura scan, but the ambient, atmospheric readings came back with normal ranges. Zuriek was still speaking.
You've been attached to Typhon's command since he took his splinter fleet and went on his sojourn. Calgaro has his questions about what happened during the first captain while he was away, and there are few we could trust to be...
He faltered briefly, as if losing his way.
To be forthright, you are among that number.
I know little I can tell you,
the veteran admitted, shifting his heavy frame against the safety restraints that held him in place.
Typhon had little use for me. I think he kept me down here because he knows I think he's an upstart. I knew him at the beginning, Raheb, just as I know you, before you were uplifted to the Legion.
He trailed off, although all that remained of his flesh was interred in a plasteel coffin at the heart of the Contemptor's powerful cybernetic mechanism. The Bitterblood still remained more human than machine, and a pang of concern cut through him as he scanned Zuriek's biosigns. The young warrior's flesh was ruddy and filmed with oily sweat, and the veteran immediately recognized the signature effects of legionary internal implants operating over capacity. Even at a remove, he could tell that Zuriek's preomnor, oolitic kidney, and Laramon's organ were all engaged in fighting something within him.
Lad,
he said sharply, as Zuriek's attention drifted away into the middle distance.
Are you injured?
On the subchannel Voxlink, the Bitterblood was already transmitting a priority request for an apothecary.
What has sickened you?
I don't know.
Zuriek pawed at his gauntlets, sluggishly pulling them free to let the metal gloves clatter to the deck.
This fatigue came upon me suddenly as I moved down ship to find you.
The legionary took a step and wavered abruptly as if he had been struck in the gut.
Ah!
The Bitterblood's concern overrode his decorum, and he broke himself free of the safety locks, rising to advance on the other Death Guard.
Raheb, look at me!
I...
Zuriek tried to raise his hand, but then a rolling shock of pain went through the warrior with such force that it silenced him. He went rigid and gagged, a grotesque liquid choking emitted from his open mouth. And suddenly, Zuriek was vomiting a jet of viscous black bile, spewing it across the deck plates. He cried out in raw agony and sank to his knees before retching again, his hunched form quaking in uncontrolled spasms. The veteran went to his side, the Contemptor stooping down to gather him up. And as he did, the Bitterblood sensors registered something in the dark pool of steaming ejecta. Tiny forms that resembled maggots were hatching as he watched, turning inside out to become silver-black flies with wet, flickering wings. Zuriek howled and drew into himself, his dense bones cracking against one another with the force of a palsy. Drawn back by the legionaries' cries, two of the serfs stood mouths agape at the chamber entrance, and for a moment the veteran thought they were struck dumb by the sight of a nigh invulnerable death guard in such agony. But then, the human menials began clawing at their exposed skin and screaming, before they too spat out their innards in streaming black floods.
"Contagion!"
bellowed the Bitterblood, the word at once a digitized shout and a warning broadcast across the Voxnet.
"Contagion here! Seal the decks!"
A trembling hand reached up and clawed at the veteran's armor.
"Help me!"
gasped Zuriek, as his eyes turned milky. All across the legionary's exposed flesh, hundreds of livid boils were rising to the surface of his skin, each one set in a cluster of three.